Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar about hatchery hygiene. My name is Gert De Lange and I'm a senior poultry specialist at Royal Pasry Farm. It is great to be speaking with all of you today. Before we start, I would like to explain a few things. One of them is that there will be three polls during this presentation, and you have approximately 30 seconds to pick your answer, which you will see in the bottom of your screen. And then I will refer to those questions, or to your answers later on. And of course, you are also very much invited to ask questions by using the chat function. And in the last 15 minutes of this presentation, I will try as much as I can to answer your questions. And most likely there will be too many questions, so the remaining questions we will answer in the course of this week, and by middle of next week, I suppose, you will receive all these answers by email. So let's get started with this presentation. First of all, I would like to talk about the importance of hygiene. And maybe it's good to start with what we are actually talking about when we talk about hygiene, and that is pathogens. We're talking about pathogens because they are the ones that are causing the trouble in the hatchery. And then we talk about bacteria, fungi, viruses, and mycoplasma. And these pathogens, we have to fight, actually. We have to deal with them because they are the ones who are causing lower hatchability. That affects our business straight away. Of course, they can also result in rotten eggs and exploders. And then, of course, transmission of diseases to the chicks that you are selling, and this might eventually lead even to a higher first week mortality. And if you take it to a higher level, you can also say that these pathogens can put the reputation of your hatchery at a risk, because if you have problems with the chicks that you sell, your customers might start complaining. And even when we take it to a next level, it could even have a negative effect on public health. Talk about, for example, a salmonella infection. And we do not want to use antibiotics, so if we sell healthy chicks without pathogens from the hatchery, there is also less need to use antibiotics. When we look to the hatchery, we see a normal situation. There are a few supplying farms, breeder flocks, supplying eggs to the hatchery. We see the hatchery in the middle, and then the hatchery is supplying chicks to many, many customers. And this is the normal situation. Now, what can happen is that one breeder farm is getting infected, for example, by a vertical transmittable disease like Salmonella enteritidis or Mycoplasma gallisepticum. And as this is a vertical transmittable disease, the farm who receives chicks from this batch of eggs will also be infected, which is represented by the red squares in this diagram. As long as we do proper monitoring, we will find out that this breeder farm is infected, and we can take action and we can stop this infection route. But if we don't take hygiene serious, the entire hatchery can get contaminated, and we are now speaking about horizontal transmission of diseases. So it started with a vertical transmission, and it ended up to be a horizontal transmission of diseases, causing the entire hatchery to be infected. And you see now that many other farms, even receiving chicks from other breeder farms, are also infected. And to make it matters worse, we can also see the situation developing where, for example, the truck that is picking the eggs from the hatchery, from the breeder farm, I'm sorry, is carrying the disease from the hatchery to the breeder farm. So the hatchery is in the middle, playing an important role in maintaining this hygiene. If the hatchery does not take the role of hygiene seriously, the entire poultry chain is being put at risk. What we will see in this picture here is a slide of our Smart Center Pro, and this is a batch-specific traceability info. because it could very well be that one of the farms, the broiler farms, is infected with Salmonella. This might be found out, and then you would like to know what other parent stock flocks were incubated in the same setter. And then you can also probably warn other farms that they might be infected. Now, talking about hygiene, that is actually quite a difficult topic, because when we ask people what is hygiene, what do you mean by hygiene, we get all kind of different answers. And if you look into the dictionaries, you get long sentences, which you can read yourself, like in the Cambridge Dictionary or what the World Health Organization is saying about it. But the problem with these definitions is they are not very practical. So can we do better? Can we make a more practical definition of hygiene? And I think we can. If we take the hatchery again as a gray box, and we know that the hatchery is receiving eggs from the breeder farm, and eggs are going in and chicks are going out. But I do not want to talk about eggs and chicks per se. I want to talk about these pathogens. So basically, with the eggs, pathogens can enter the hatchery, and with the chicks, pathogens can leave the hatchery. Now, if you look to other things that enter the hatchery, that's for example people, they can potentially carry pathogens into the hatchery. Air can be contaminated with pathogens. And if we look even further, we can talk about equipment and tools, we can talk about water, and I even put a question mark, which it could be anything. Think about a mobile telephone, for example. And they can all bring in pathogens into the hatchery. But that's not the only part we should consider. We should also look to the transportation of pathogens within the hatchery, because there is also a potential that, for example, pathogens travel from the chick room by air to the setter room, or, for example, people walk from the transfer room through exploded eggs and they go to see the egg handling room. So there is even horizontal transmission within the hatchery. And when we talk about a practical definition of hygiene, basically what we have to do is to stop all these infection routes. So the first one is we have to avoid that pathogens enter the hatchery. And we can call that vector management. And another word that is often used for this is biosecurity. Then a next level, the next step in hygiene, is to avoid that pathogens within the hatchery are being transported. So we have to avoid cross-contamination. It is absolutely impossible to keep the hatchery free of pathogens. Even when you take step one and two very serious, there will always be some pathogens in your hatchery. So your last step, and this is often by many people said, hygiene is cleaning and disinfection. For me, cleaning and disinfection is actually only the last step of hygiene measures. We have to prevent the further development of pathogens into the hatchery. And you have to ask yourself a question, what or where or who is the weakest link in your chain of hygiene measures? Because the weakest link in this chain will jeopardize your hatchery hygiene. And if you can answer this question, if you know what is the weakest link in your chain, you have to fix it, you have to solve it. And often this has to do with behavior and attitude. I would like to go to a poll. And the poll is, where can you make the greatest improvement in your hatchery hygiene management? I will give you about 30 seconds to choose your answer. Do I get the answers in? I don't think I will see them. Probably a bit later. Let's continue with the presentation. First of all, I would like to talk about vector management. So to prevent that pathogens enter your hatchery. And what is actually quite a nice exercise, we do it sometimes during our hatchery management training, is to sit together and to make a list of everything, simply everything that enters your hatchery. You can also do that together with your staff. And then the question you have to ask is, does this really need to enter the hatchery? Think about, for example, lunch. Do people have to carry in lunch to the hatchery? Do they have to take in their mobile telephone to the hatchery? If the answer is yes, well, in that case, you have to see how can you reduce the risk that people bring in pathogens. So, for example, if people have to bring in their telephone, you can say, okay, fine, but then we have to disinfect it before you bring it in by using alcohol wipes, for example. I got the reply of you on the poll. Most people have said that they can make the biggest impact and biggest improvement in hatchery management by vector management, so biosecurity. So that's actually the topic that we are talking about now. The next group is cleaning and disinfection. 33% of the people think that there is where they can make the best improvement. And cross-contamination is actually only 24%. Okay, we continue. Hatching eggs we cannot do without hatching eggs. Of course not. We need hatching eggs in our hatchery. But we do not want to bring pathogens with those eggs into the hatchery. So we have to look to two steps. We have to look to the external or even internal contamination. So we have to focus on egg quality, on egg handling, on disinfection. One of the questions that you have to ask yourself is, do I have to set floor eggs? What do I do with dirty eggs? What do I do with cracked eggs? Because these eggs are potential risks for your hatchery, as they might develop into exploding eggs, into bangers. Vertical transmission, we know that certain diseases will travel by the egg yolk to the offspring. And the only thing you can do, and it's quite important, is to have a proper monitoring process being applied. For example, as you see on the slide, taking fluff samples of every hatch to test for the presence of salmonella. And once you find salmonella in the fluff, this is a signal that the breeder flock could potentially be contaminated with salmonella and you have to take action. Then people. People need, of course, also to enter the hatchery. Of course, your staff has to enter the hatchery, but what about visitors? Do you allow visitors in? And if you do, you want them to make a registration, first of all, to declare that they are themselves are healthy, that they are not carrier of salmonella, for example, or not affected by any flu or anything like that. And you also want them to tell you that they have not been in another hatchery or in another poultry farm in the last, for example, 72 hours. And you also make them sign that they agree to follow the hygienic rules in your hatchery. What I see often in hatcheries when I visit them is that there is a shower room, but what happens is you go in to the shower and you have to get out of the shower on the same door where you entered to put on hatchery clothes. So you can imagine in such a situation, you're stepping back into a dirty area. The red arrow on the picture is where you enter, and that is dirty. So you should not go back to there. You should actually go to the green arrow on the right-hand side. That is the clean part of the hatchery. So it should be one door in, one door out. Also, it is important, for example, to think about, should your staff members be allowed to keep chickens at home? Are they allowed to keep poultry? Then about equipment and tools. Example is egg trays. Egg trays could be from paper egg trays, and they are quite safe in the sense that they are normally in hatcheries used only once. After being used, they are being disposed of. But if you use plastic trays, or even setter trays, you cannot throw them away after one-time use. You have to use them again. So before you send them back to the breeder farm, they have to be proper cleaned and disinfected. And that is quite an important way also to keep pathogens out of your hatchery, because you do not want to move pathogens from one place to the other by your setter trays. The same goes for transport trolleys. And those equipment that is coming back into the hatchery, transport trolleys for egg trays, transport trolleys for chick boxes, you have to make sure that also the drivers don't go into the hatchery to push those trolleys inside. Tools, very important is that tools could be carriers of pathogens. And what you see on the picture on this slide is that the technical room, that's what we normally try to do when we design a hatchery. The technical room of the hatchery, we try to put it on the outside such that it can be accessed through an external door. That means that people who go into this room to repair, for example, the boiler or a pump, they do not have to pass through the hatchery with their tools. And the same goes actually for offices and meeting rooms. Pests is another one. Rodents, flies, birds, even, well, it's not a pest, it's a pet, the dog, the pet animal. The hatchery manager should not do his evening round with his dog, because that dog could also bring in pathogens into your hatchery. Now, normally people think that when you have pests, what you have to do is to use as much as possible rodenticides and insecticides, and that's how you control the pest. But in fact, what you would like to do is to prevent that the pest will develop. So what you have to do is to actually learn and understand, for example, what is the behavior of rodents. Take an example of mice. A mice can pass through a hole in your hatchery, which is as small as your little pinky finger. So if you have holes in your hatchery, you know that mice can enter. So if you make your hatchery rodent-proof, you close all the holes, then those animals cannot go in. Also keeping around your hatchery neat and tidy. Don't leave waste bins piling up, hatchery waste where larvae can develop. Don't leave it around, but get rid of it as soon as possible. Don't invite the pests to your hatchery. And if you do that properly, you might not even have to use rodenticides or insecticides. Going to air, good to realize that by air, it is possible that viruses can travel quite a long distance, and you do not want these viruses into your hatchery. So normally when you build a new hatchery, you try to build it in an area where it is free of other poultry farms, let's say at least 3 kilometers away from another farm. And maybe also preferably not too close to a feed mill. Also keep the direction of the wind into consideration. For example, you see at this picture a waste handling unit, you see a cyclone, and that one is of course producing some amount of dust with loaded with bacteria and viruses. And you do not want your waste handling unit outside of the hatchery to be placed on the side from where the wind is coming, such that all that dirt will blow over your hatchery and at the other side will be inhaled by the air handling unit. To stop waste of dirt particles to enter your hatchery, we are usually working with an F7 filter. And an F7 filter will stop quite a bit of particles, but not everything, of course. Oxygen has to go through. If you look to this picture, you will see that bacteria are too big to pass through a filter like this. But viruses actually can pass through an F7 filter. Luckily, most viruses attach themselves to dust particles, and by that way, they are still being caught. But if you run, for example, a GPS hatchery, where it is much more important to keep pathogens out of your hatchery, you might have to invest in a more expensive filter, which is stopping more smaller particles. Last but not least, in the series of factors that can carry in pathogens into your hatchery is to consider water. We need water in our hatchery for cleaning, for showering, even for drinking water. But we should be careful that this water is not contaminated, for example, with E. coli bacteria or Pseudomonas bacteria. So we have to think about what's the source of the water. Maybe we need to chemically treat the water or even use ultraviolet light to treat the water. And we should have some kind of quality control in place. Okay, I go to the next chapter, and that is to avoid cross-contamination. And this is bringing me to the next poll. And the next poll is, in your hatchery, do eggs being transferred to the hatcher ever cross the path of the chicks just being pulled? I give you about 30 seconds to think about it. I will come back to the results of this poll in one of the next slides. Talking about avoiding cross-contamination, we have to design our hatchery such that we have clear, demarked hygienic zones. We have an egg arrival area, we have a setter room, a kennelling and transfer room, a hatchery room, and a chick handling room. Those are the five hygienic zones in the hatchery. And the cleanest of these zones, what we call the heart of the hatchery, is actually the setter room. That room, that setter room, is should be seen as the most clean part of the hatchery. And what we have to do is to design hatchery such that as much as possible we have a unidirectional flow of everything that moves around in the hatchery. Eggs, well, that's mostly not the problem. Eggs are coming in on one side and chicks are leaving on the other side, so that is usually the easiest of the issues. But people could be quite a risk. People could easily walk, for example, think about the technical engineer fixing a problem with the chick counter, and then the next thing he has to go to the setter room because there is an alarm in the setter room. Is this person walking all the way from the chick room full of fluff to the setter room, or will he take hygienic precautions? Air is another one. Air is very much able to carry the fluff from the hatches and from the chick room back to the setter room. So what we normally do in the setter room, we apply a positive air pressure, and in the fluff tunnel, on the slide on the bottom on the right-hand side, you see a fluff tunnel. The fluff tunnel or the exhaust plenum of the hatches is kept in a negative pressure. And by doing such, we avoid that air will travel pathogens through the hatchery. And the same goes for trays and baskets and boxes and trolleys. The rule that we should try to follow, the rule that we should try to apply, is that clean should never meet dirty. So if you take, for example, the egg arrival area as an example, we receive eggs in the egg arrival area, we put the eggs on setter trolleys and setter trays, then we move them to the setter room, and as soon as they go into the setter room, we will already call those trays dirty because there are potential exploding eggs. Those trays will not stay clean. So they go in clean into the setter room, but by the time they leave the setter room and go to kennelling and transfer, we have to consider those setter trays and setter trolleys as dirty. We have to wash them, and at the moment they are washed, they are very clean again, washed and disinfected. By the time you push them back to the egg arrival area, you do not want to bump into chicks, for example, or dirty trays or dirty trolleys. You want to maintain this route of clean should never meet dirty. Make it a little bit more practical. We see eggs being transferred from the setter trays to the hatcher basket. And then 3 days later, we have chicks. Now, coming back to the poll, yeah, does it happen at times that chicks in the hatcher basket at pulling time meet eggs being loaded into the hatcher? I see that 66% of the people watching this seminar said this never ever happens in my hatchery. And 26% says, yes, this happens sometimes within the same hatchery room. Well, if everything is well organized, you practice all in, all out per hatchery room. And if everything is well organized, your hatchery room has one door for loading on the side of the transfer room, and you have another door, an exit door, for unloading at the day of the hatch. And in that way, you can very easily avoid that chicks contaminate eggs that are coming in. But what I see sometimes in hatcheries is that the pressure is so much, and the hatchery rooms are sometimes a little bit oversized, and they're already cleaning the hatches, chicks out, hatches are being cleaned, and from the other side, eggs are already coming in because the work pressure is that high that they cannot wait for the hatches, for the entire hatchery room to be clean. And I guess that that is what people say when they say 26%, 26% of the time it happens in the same hatchery room. And 8%, and that is a little bit to my surprise, says, yes, this happens in our hatchery all the time. So there is still some room for improvement. Here we see the movement of the farm trolleys, the setter trolleys, and the hatchery dollies within a hatchery. And if you look very clearly to these circles, you see that clean is never meeting dirty. So when you design a hatchery, when you are building a new hatchery, you should be able to draw these lines into the hatchery and to see that clean and dirty never matches. I would like to make a practical example of cross-contamination. And that's about the transfer of eggs. You see on this picture exploding eggs. And you can imagine that you can carry this dirt from one batch of eggs to the next. So therefore, the advice would be always to start transferring the eggs of the younger flocks, because in younger flocks, all of us know that there is less risk for exploders. So if you start on the working day with transferring the younger flocks, and then you do the older flocks, there will be less risk. Of course, there is always a possibility that an egg will explode, so make sure that you have a bucket available with a disinfectant inside, and you can dispose of your eggs immediately as you see them into that bucket. Clean up immediately after each banger. Also, the vacuum heads, the ones that lift the eggs off the setter tray into the hatchery basket, should be cleaned at least daily. And when we do in-oval vaccination, hygiene is becoming even more important. And a good development that we see nowadays is that we can actually recognize these rotten eggs even when they are not looking like the ones on the picture, where you can see this is a potential exploder. Nowadays, with the modern technology, we can also see that eggs are rotten inside when we use this heartbeat technology. And those eggs are also nowadays, much more than before, being sucked away into a vacuum waste system. So with this, we greatly improve the hygiene, which is needed for in-ovo vaccination. And also when you use a separator, for example, you do not want to have eggs exploding on your separator. We talked about biosecurity, we talked about avoiding cross-contamination in the hatchery, and the next chapter, the next part of the measures that you can take for hygiene is cleaning and disinfection to avoid and prevent further development of pathogens. If we look to a hatchery, actually we can say that the hatchery is the ideal place for bacteria and fungi to grow and to thrive. First of all, food. Bacteria need food to grow and to multiply. And in the hatchery, there's quite a lot of food available. A broken egg on the floor, fluff, blood, manure, all this organic material, which we call dirt, is basically food for bacteria. So we have to practice cleaning. We have to keep the hatchery clean. Water. We should make as much as possible sure that our hatchery is clean. If you have, for example, condensation on cool water lines and you have dripping of water on the floor all the time, you are providing water to your bacteria and your fungi to grow. So you have to keep your hatchery as much as you can clean. Air. Bacteria, most bacteria and fungi need air. Can we do without air? Can we do anything to take air out of the hatchery? Yeah, no, we cannot. We need air also for the embryos to grow. So there's nothing we can do. The same applies to heat. Incubation is typically something that requires a nice temperature of approximately 100 Fahrenheit. And that's the exact temperature that bacteria like to multiply at. So there's also not much we can do there. Privacy, well, that is something we can work on. In the olden days, we had wooden incubators, wooden tools in the hatchery, like wooden brooms and wooden floor rubbers, etc. Wood is not something that is smooth enough. It has little cracks, and bacteria can easily hide in there. The same goes for concrete floors. If the concrete floor is not properly sealed off and has little cracks, bacteria can hide themselves there and can stay out of reach of disinfectants. So we have to make sure that we avoid cracks and we have smooth surfaces. In the hatchery, the pathogens, bacteria, for example, can multiply very, very rapidly once they are exposed to the ideal temperature. And the ideal temperature is equal to incubation temperature. And one bacteria doubles to two, and two becomes four, and that happens in a normal situation every 20 minutes. And if you make a calculation, in less than 7 hours, one bacteria is already more than 1 million bacteria. So the conclusion, we cannot allow bacteria to multiply at this rapid rate. What we have to do is to kill them before they become a problem by regular cleaning and disinfection. So then, what do we clean? And at which frequency? Well, we have to make a division. We have to clean and disinfect after each cycle, for example, setters and hatches and trucks and egg handling equipment like setter trays or chick boxes. After every use, you have to clean and disinfect. There are also some rooms in the hatchery, like a canteen, like showers, toilets, corridors, where you might not want to, well, you cannot clean after every use because you use it constantly. But at least you have to make a schedule that you clean and disinfect those rooms once a week, and maybe even more frequently. The procedure for cleaning and disinfecting, and I'm using as an example a hatcher, is to start, first of all, to remove the loose dirt. What you should typically not do is to start straight away by using the high-pressure cleaner, because everybody knows a hatcher at the end of the hatch is full of fluff and dust and shell particles. And if you start blowing around with a high pressure cleaner, you just spread dirt from one side to the other. If you first take a broom or floor rubber and you collect that dirt and put it into a bin, then it makes your cleaning much, much easier. And the next step is to apply soap. And then to let that soap do its job for a couple of minutes, like at least 5 minutes, 10 minutes, let the soap do its activity. And what you see on the picture is that soap is actually clinging to the wall. It does not drain down fast, it stays to do its soaking. Then the next is to use water, plenty water, to rinse away that dirt and that soap into your drainage system. And if you use soap in a good way, you do not need to use high pressure. You can work with plenty of water at a relatively low pressure, and then you wash away all the dirt. The next step, step number four, is sometimes being forgotten. But it's, to my opinion, drying your hatcher or anything that you clean before you go to the next step, the disinfectant step, is quite important. Because if your hatcher floor is, for example, still wet, and let's say there is even a puddle of water, if you apply a disinfectant at the proper dilution rate onto a wet floor, you actually dilute your disinfectant again. And then your disinfectant might not be effective enough. So I would say always make sure that you dry your equipment that you want to disinfect before applying the disinfectant. There are a few items in the hatchery that are quite sensitive to be in touch with water and to be in touch with a high pressure cleaner. And you see the examples on the picture. It does, of course, not mean that these items should not be cleaned and disinfected, but please not with a high pressure cleaner. What you can do is to wipe them with a wet cloth soaked in a little bit of soap, and later on with a cloth soaked with some disinfectant. But they need to be cleaned. Cleaning and disinfection is always something that goes hand in hand. You cannot disinfect anything without proper cleaning first. If you clean properly, already 80 till 85% of the microorganisms are gone. You wash them away simply with dirt and the washing water. And there are also quite a lot of disinfectants that do not work in the presence of organic material. So if you do not remove the dirt from, for example, your hatchie wall, your disinfectant is simply not going to work. Let's go for another poll. And the question is, are you using soap for cleaning your hatches? And the question is a little bit more specific. Do you know what kind of soap are you using? Are you using an alkaline soap or an acid soap? Or maybe you are using both? Or probably you have no idea which kind of soap you are using. So do you use soap for cleaning, for example, hatches? Yes or no? And if you know what kind of soap, please specify. I go to explain the principles of cleaning. And we do that by the Sinner circle. The Sinner circle shows you the four factors that are responsible for proper cleaning. Of course, cleaning takes a certain amount of time. And depending on how you apply the other factors, for example, if I want to clean a dirty plate with a very soft piece of cloth, it takes forever. But when I use a strong brush, it is more easy to clean that plate. So power could be muscle power, a brush, a broom, or even a scraper, but it could also be a high pressure cleaner. So you could say I use high pressure and my cleaning result will be very good, and I can then work a bit faster. You can also make the cleaning result more effective by using a higher temperature. Fat, for example, is organic material. We find it also in the hatchery. Think about a broken egg, a broken yolk, contains quite a lot of fat. If you work with a higher temperature, you dissolve the fat and you get a more easy cleaning process, which is then again taking less time. And last but not least, you can use some chemistry in the form of soap. Now, if we look to this picture here, we see on the left-hand side that the green field is very small, and that means there is no use of soap. There's no use of very little use of chemistry. That means that you need quite a long time for cleaning. You need probably a high temperature, and you might need quite a high power pressure to get a proper cleaning result. If I am going to soak with soap, that's the picture in the middle, you see the chemistry, the green bar is bigger now, and that means that now I can work with a lower pressure. I do not need to apply a high pressure anymore. I can apply relatively low pressure, plenty water, and I am not tempted to use very high temperature water anymore. The time factor looks like it has increased a lot. That is true, the time has increased, but you see that one part of the time, this, the bigger part of the time factor, is waiting time for the soap to do its action. So you foam your hatcher, you foam your object that you want to clean, and while the foam is doing its job, you can do something else. You can go to clean the next hatchie. You can drink a cup of coffee. By the time you're coming back to do the cleaning, the time that you need is very small. What you see on the right-hand side is actually soap molecules. Those little blue things are soap molecules, and they show what soap is actually doing. Soap has a head, and the head of the soap molecule is very happy with water. It likes water. And the tail of the soap is catching the dirt. So basically what the soap is doing is keeping the dirt suspended in water such that you can easily flow it away. I'm going to talk a little bit more in detail about soap. You have seen in the previous slides that using soap is useful. And on the poll, I see that only 1% of the people who responded say, no, we only use water. So majority of you is using soap, and because you do that because you see the benefits of it. And I see that most people say, yes, we use only alkaline soap. 5% says we only use acid soap. 23% says we alternate alkaline and acid. And 35% of the respondents say, yes, we use soap, but we have no clue whether it is alkaline or acid. Now, let me explain a little bit better about the function of alkaline soap, acid soap, and why there might be a need to alternate. Alkaline soap, that means soap with a high pH, removes organic material like fats and protein. And basically, that's the deal, the dirt that we are dealing with in the hatchery. So in a normal situation, it would be enough to use only alkaline soap. However, the water that you use for cleaning contains calcium carbonates, it contains minerals. And if you constantly use water with minerals, you will realize that after a certain time, your walls of your hatchery, your floors, everything is getting a little bit whitish because of the calcium carbonate built up. And then again, the dirt will stick more to this surface because it's not smooth anymore. It's more easy for the dirt to stick there. And those calcium carbonates make cleaning more difficult. And if you want to get rid of those calcium carbonates, you can not do that with alkaline soap. You need an acid soap for that. And for that reason, it is good every now and again, depending on the hardness of your water and depending if you see this whitish material start to form on your smooth surfaces, to alternate with an acid soap. So let's say you use normally alkaline soap, and once in the 3, 4, 5 weeks, depending on the hardness of the water, you want to take action to take away the calcium carbonates by using acid. Then the question about the soap to be answered is, do we want to use a foaming soap or a non-foaming soap? If you have a washer for hatchery baskets, for example, it is not logic to use a foaming soap. If you do, you will see that your hatchery washing room, your washing room will be full of soap. You cannot enter anymore after a while. It will be one big soapy mess. So that is not a good idea to do. But if you want to wash the wall of a hatchery, that soap, that foam that you want to create, is very important, because if there is no foam, the soap will just run off and does not do its job. So basically, for cleaning hatches and setters and walls in rooms, we like a foaming detergent, but in washing machines, a non-foaming detergent. And then about chlorine, in washes for baskets and trays, it's quite common to use chlorinated soaps. Those washes are made from stainless steel, but the equipment from which your setters and hatches are being made, copper, aluminium, maybe even galvanized iron, they don't go very happily together with chlorine. So in that case, it's better to not use a chlorinated soap. It's not only a soap that we have to choose, we also have to choose disinfectants. And it's actually quite a long list of questions you see here. And for me, it is not easy to give an answer on all these questions, but what I would like you to realize is, when you have to choose a soap and a disinfectant, you have to talk to your supplier. And the questions that are listed here are actually the questions that you should ask your supplier. And depending on the answers you get from your supplier, together with him, you can choose good products. And for example, you want to know if the product that you are buying, the disinfectant you want to buy, does it work against all the microorganisms that you want to find, to fight? And does it work in the presence of organic material? Yeah, if you don't clean properly, would it then be logic to use a chlorine-based product? No, it won't, because a chlorinated product does not work in the presence of dirt. Sodium hydroxide, for example, does. It is very powerful, even in a dirty environment, it will disinfect. But again, that is very highly corrosive. It's not safe for your material. So all these questions that you see here, you should basically ask to your supplier, including, of course, the price. The price is also relevant. But if you put the price on top and you go for cheap, you might end up buying alcohol. Alcohol is very cheap. It does disinfect, but it has absolutely no residual power. It evaporates very quickly and it does not stay. So that might not be your best choice. So price, I like to put that at the bottom. Also good to realize that when you buy a commercial product, it is often a combination of different active ingredients which work together, like in a complementary action. I will explain that in the next slide. But it's not only active compounds that we are talking about when we talk about disinfectants. We also see that the suppliers put different chemicals into the bins, into the canisters. For example, buffering agents to stabilize the product. Wetting agents so that the product will be more easily spread and reach everywhere. Sequestering agents to make sure that the product also works in hard water with a high calcium content. Or corrosion inhibitors. So it's not just chemical you buy to kill the bacteria or the fungi or the viruses, but also making it a better product, for example, more material safe. Let me give you an example of complementary action. For example, a product consists of alcohol. Alcohol is working to take away the fat from the wall of the cell of the bacteria. Then the next product that you find in the same canister could, for example, be quaternary ammonium compounds. Quaternary ammonium compounds, as you can see in this table, they are not active against naked viruses. But a good thing about quaternary ammonium compounds is that they penetrate into the cell wall. So the alcohol is making the cell wall clean, such that the quaternary ammonium compounds can enter the cell wall. But I still need something else to kill the naked viruses. And often in these combination products is also an addition of aldehydes, and they are working again to go into the, they are entering into the cell which is damaged by the quaternary ammonium compounds, and they are killing the nucleus of the bacteria. So a commercial product could, for example, consist of these three active components. Important is to follow the user instructions. And this is the responsibility, I would say, of the hatchery manager. There are very complicated labels and user manuals coming with these chemicals, and you cannot expect your staff to read all these user instructions. So you have to train them, and you are also responsible to tell your staff about safety measures. Now, luckily, on most canisters, it's not just a lot of text, but there's also symbols. So try to teach your staff the importance of the symbols. Let them use the product at the proper dilution rate. If they have to rinse after applying, for example, a soap you need to rinse after applying, let them do that properly. Give them the proper protective wear and also enforce that they use it. So that is quite important to understand. And maybe also a very important one is don't let your staff mix any chemicals, because that could be quite dangerous. If you mix, for example, chlorine with acid, you get a very poisonous gas. So let people not mix chemicals themselves. I go to the final chapter to discuss with you, and that's about monitoring. Because we do clean and disinfect, and we hope that we are doing a good job, but if we do not monitor, then we cannot rely on the results. And we can monitor basically at three levels. The first level, you can do that almost every day. As long as you walk around in your hatchery, you can check if your staff visually did a good job on cleaning. And do not look only to the obvious parts like the floor and the wall, but also look, for example, on the inside of a door rubber, as the picture is showing. Look to the inside of an exhaust pipe, etc. If it is visually clean, then, well, that's the first step, very important to go to disinfecting. Later I will show you that there is also a possibility that something which is visually clean might still be contaminated, and by protein residue testing, on the next slide it's explained, you can make clear that it is probably not properly cleaned yet. Second level of monitoring is to check, are there any bacteria or fungi still being present on a surface which looks like clean? Because cleaning does not mean that all the bacteria and fungi are gone. And we can take, for example, swabs, but we can also take raw duct plates, and with this we can check the number of bacteria that have survived the cleaning and disinfecting process. But this is non-specific. I do not care if it is a salmonella or a staphylococcus or a streptococcus or an E. coli. I just want to know, are any bacteria, any fungi there still being present? If I want to know specifically, then I have to take samples and probably send them to the laboratory with the question, please check if there is any salmonella present in my sample. You see here two bottoms of Hatcher baskets. And we know that a Hatcher basket has to be very clean for the next chicks to hatch in, because if Hatcher baskets are dirty, you have a higher risk of yolk sac infection and problems in the broiler farm. So it's important that the Hatcher baskets are properly cleaned. And visually, we see that two baskets show that they are clean. The basket on the left shows a green coloring in the residue test for protein, meaning that that basket indeed is clean. There is no leftover protein. But the basket on the right is showing a purple color, and purple means there is still protein residue present. So the cleaning was not done correctly. And this is something that you could also utilize for staff training, to make them aware that clean visually does not mean clean in reality, and that sometimes a better job is being needed. Sampling locations in the hatchery, of course you can make your own list, but you have to make kind of a summary of your hatchery, the different rooms, and to check every room thoroughly. And you see that, for example, more samples are being taken into the hatcher rooms and in the hatcher than compared to the canteen. And what you can do, and this is a method I like very much, and we also usually demonstrate during our hatchery management training, is instead of using swabs, because what is the problem with swabs? You send them usually to the laboratory and you get back a piece of paper with numbers on it, and people have to interpret those numbers. But you do not actually see the bacteria. With raw duct plates, which is basically a petri dish with nutrients for bacteria, you press it on the sampling surface, you incubate it at incubation temperature, about 38, 37 centigrades, and after 1 day, 2 days, you can actually count the bacteria colonies. So you make the invisible enemy, you make it actually visible for your staff to see. And then what you see here is just the way we rate it in the Netherlands, according to our standards. If you see no colonies, you have score 0, and if you have, for example, 325, it's score 3, etc. And at the end of the day, you take the average of every room, and that gives you the rating. And by this way, you can visualize the invisible enemy, you can show the weak points in your cleaning and disinfection protocol, and you can use that again to train your staff in doing a better job. If the results of this monitoring are not satisfactory, we have to analyze why not. Why do still bacteria, fungi survive my cleaning and disinfection protocol? Well, probably you did not dilute properly. You have too low a concentration of chemicals. Maybe because you applied the chemical on a wet floor. Maybe the temperature is the issue. A nice example is formalin. Formalin is only active at temperatures above 20 centigrades. So if you disinfect hatching eggs that come straight from the storage room and they are 15 centigrades warm, and you apply formalin, you might not get very good disinfection results. The acidity is also an important factor. If you use an acid soap and you do not rinse properly, you leave an acid environment. And some of the disinfectants simply do not work in an acid environment. And other chemicals, again, do not work in an alkaline environment. So that's why rinsing the soap is very important. Also, infection pressure is an important issue. Maybe you did an excellent cleaning and disinfecting job, but soon after, due to the way you work in your hatchery, the area is recontaminated. So the infection pressure is too high. Maybe your hatchery design is not good. Maybe you don't have a very clearly demarked clean area, dirty area, and people just walking all across. And maybe the chemicals that you have used simply are not effective against the bacteria or fungi you are trying to find, to fight. So all in all, monitoring helps you to do a better cleaning and disinfection protocol. I wish all of you good luck with fighting the invisible enemy, because basically that is what we are trying to do. And I'm ready now to take your questions and your answers. You have sent in answers to chat function, and my colleagues will show me on my screen the questions, and I will try to answer them. Yes, let me start with the first question. I will read it loud. In one of your first slides, you did not mention protozoa and parasites as pathogens. Are those not relevant? Well, I agree. I mentioned bacteria, fungi, viruses, and mycoplasma, because I think those are the most important when we talk about hatchery hygiene. But definitely protozoa, like coccidiosis, or parasites, like worms, potentially they could also enter the hatchery if you take in eggs which are, for example, soiled with manure. However, I think that they are not really playing a role in getting your chicks or your eggs really being infected. So from hatchery point of view, I don't think they are that relevant, in the sense that I do not think chicks will get infected with it. Nevertheless, bringing in eggs soiled with manure, I would not advise that, because you bring plenty of other problems into your hatchery. So I think that is my answer. Second question, would you advise to set floor eggs? And any precautions? Well, this is a nice one, because when we have hatchery management training, we usually ask the participants, do you agree with the following statement? A floor egg is not a hatching egg. And almost every person in the training says, yes, we agree with you. And then they are silent for a while, and they start smiling, and they say, but, and now we come to the real practice, in most hatcheries, you cannot afford not to set the floor eggs. They are coming to your hatchery, and sometimes you're even forced to set them. You know that you run a higher risk with them, because floor eggs have the risk of being contaminated. You have more exploding eggs in those eggs. You get lower results, but you still have to set them. Now, what you can do in such a case, first of all, you should know which eggs are floor eggs and which ones not. It's important that the breeder farm is keeping those eggs separate and labels the floor eggs as being floor eggs. That allows you as a hatchery manager to handle them in a specific way. And the specific way that I recommend, which is usually also practiced in hatcheries, is to put the floor eggs on the bottom trays in your trolleys. Because if you do that and they explode, dirt has the tendency to fall down. If you have floor eggs on top and they explode, everything below will get contaminated. Everything below will get dirty. So putting the floor eggs on your bottom trays will at least minimize the contamination of the remaining eggs in the machine. Probably another thing you could do, I know this is not as practical as my previous example of setting them at the bottom, but you could, for example, do a 10-day candling on the floor eggs only. If you see already that those eggs contain dead embryos, or are even blackish on the inside, or they have probably already started to develop a bad smell, you can take them out before they bang. However, most important, I would like to stress, if you have to set a lot of floor eggs on a regular basis because there is so much floor eggs coming to your hatchery, talk to the breeder farm managers and let them try to take precautions to minimize the number of floor eggs. Because we know that floor eggs don't give very good results. Next question. That's a difficult one. I cannot answer it straight away, but the question is, how often should we replace the air filter in the air handling unit? I do not know if you recall the picture with the air filter. The F7 filter was pink. By the time the F7 filter is totally black, you are too late. That is an easy way to say they should not be black. You should still see the color. But how often you have to change these air filters or replace these air filters depends also on the pollution rate. If you have, for example, a hatchery in Saudi Arabia in the desert and there is a sandstorm, you might have to replace those units maybe every week. And if you are in an area where there is almost no dust in the air, you can probably change them only once in the 6 months. So I would advise to definitely regularly check your air handling unit and to regularly check the color of your filter. That's a kind of a visual inspection. Maybe also to think about the dry season and the wet season. Depending on how much dust is in the air, you might have to replace it more often. And there is also systems in place where we measure the pressure difference between before the air passes through the filter and after it passes through the filter. And if the pressure of the air after the filter is getting too low, it's a sign that the filter is starting to get blocked. It is wrong cheapness to keep the filters in, because they're expensive, but if you do not change your filter and your setters and your hatches don't get the proper amount of air anymore, you lose more hatchability than you gain with saving the money or not changing your filters. So I would, and once you know from your area how frequently you have to change, make a protocol, make a checklist. Every month, every 2 months, I have to check and I have to replace. A question, does storage time result in an increased amount of bangers? And if so, how? At first instance, I would say no, because in the storage room, temperature is very low. Bacteria do not multiply at a rapid rate in a storage room. At 16 or 18 centigrade, the multiplication rate is not every 20 minutes. It's very slow that the bacteria will multiply. Inside the eggs, we have also some, if bacteria manage to get inside, they will be killed by the high pH of the albumin and the natural antibiotic, the lysozyme in the albumin. So from that point of view, I would say there is no effect of storage time on increased amount of bangers. But if you think about it a little bit deeper, if you store eggs longer, the advice is to store them at a lower temperature. And when you store eggs at a lower temperature, and you bring them from this lower temperature, like say 12 centigrade or 14 centigrade, to your setter room, and the eggs are getting wet by condensation, sweating of eggs, this water on the eggshell will help microorganisms on the eggshell to penetrate into the egg. So in that case, if you see lower storage temperatures resulting into condensation, in that case, I would expect more bangers. Absolutely, yes. Last question on this slide for me is, if we do fumigation at the farm, should we then again do a fumigation at the hatchery before going into the setters? I would say, this is what I usually say, if you do one fumigation and you do it good, and you avoid recontamination, there is no any need to disinfect eggs for the second time. And I can also give you an example of a hatchery where they were going really crazy with disinfecting eggs. They disinfected the eggs in the farm, in the truck, on arrival, and again before setting, 4 times before entering the eggs in the setter. And they did that by using formalin. I can tell you that in this hatchery, the early mortality rate was very high. So they did not only kill the microorganisms, but they also did kill many embryos. So in general, if you disinfect eggs in the farm and you avoid recontamination, that means that your truck should be considered as a clean room, your driver should be handling those eggs without touching them. your hatchery is considered to be a clean room, no people coming in and touch these eggs with unwashed hands, etc., then there is no need to do any second disinfection. I still have time to do a few more questions, I think. In our hatchery, we only have one shower block for the entire hatchery, and it is used for all staff working in the hatchery. How then do we avoid cross-contamination by staff that goes from chick processing and staff responsible for egg setting and the set room? Well, this is actually not a very strange situation. Most hatcheries that I visit have only one shower block. There are a few exceptions, and those exceptions are usually hatcheries where they work with expensive breeding stock, like GPS hatcheries, where they have a separate entrance with showers for the set room and a separate entrance with showers for the hatch room. If you have only one shower block, indeed there is a risk that people will meet in the canteen, for example, and that the canteen becomes a kind of cross-contamination point of people from the hatch room and people from the set room. Well, what you can do, and I know it's not perfect, but it's better than doing nothing, before you leave the hatch room, before you leave the chick processing room, you are loaded with fluff, you are full of dust particles. I see in many hatcheries they use compressed air to blow that fluff, that dust off the clothes before they go to the corridor leading to the canteen. The worst part of contaminating one area, to bringing contamination from one area to the other, is your feet. And of course, when you walk in a hatchery room or in a chick processing room, your feet are very dirty. So having a foot cleaning broom, a rotating brush with disinfectant, and maybe also disinfectant containers to do your disinfection of your footwear. And washing hands. I think if you do all of that, then you have done as much as you can. There is a question here, what would be your advice for cleaning the egg storage room? And I could combine that with another question, what would be your advice for cleaning the multi-stage setter? Those are two rooms that are never free of eggs. A storage room is never empty. A multi-stage setter is almost never empty. Yet still, every now and again, an egg might fall on the floor, an egg might explode, there will be some visual dirt, you might want to do something. But you cannot go in with a high pressure cleaner because you do not want to wet all the other eggs, you do not want to raise the humidity for too much and for too long. So what you can do in these ones, these rooms, that's not much, but it's better than doing nothing, if dry cleaning. You can use a scraper. You know, when a single stage setter is empty and you see what is on the floor, it's a lot of dried egg yolk material. With a scraper, you can scrape it off the floor. You can collect it with a broom and a little lid to take it out. And then you can disinfect locally that spot on the floor with any disinfectant that you would like to use. So local cleaning of dirty areas and local disinfecting. In this egg storage room, what you might be able to do at times when the egg stock is low is to move all your eggs from one side of the room to the other side of the room and to use a machine, a scrubber, an automatic scrubber that is scrubbing the machine with some water and some soap, and at the same time, in the same move, is also sucking the water up again in a dirty water container. So in that way you can clean your egg storage room also one side first and then later on the other side. I see a question here, what are the pros and constraints of using chick paper in the hatcher baskets? If I talk about our customers, I would say that 99%, maybe 90%, let me not be too optimistic, is not using paper in the hatcher baskets. As long as you clean your baskets, your hatcher baskets properly, there is absolutely no need to use paper in the hatcher baskets. But if you are not able to get proper cleaning results from your hatcher baskets and you want to avoid infected chicks, yolk sac infection and those kind of things, well, then better than doing nothing is to put in chick paper in the hatcher baskets. In itself, it works very good. There's nothing against using chick paper in the hatchery baskets. However, it is not easy in automation processes when you have a chick separator, for example, that paper cannot pass through the separator, so you have to take it out manually. And another thing that you have to avoid when you use paper in the chick boxes, in the hatchery baskets, it should not hamper the airflow. So if that paper is a little bit too big and it is standing up vertically to the wall of the hatchery basket, then it will block the airflow, and then it will of course affect your hatch results. So I would advise always to make sure that the paper in the hatchery basket, if you have to use it, to make sure that it is small enough that it will lie down flat on the bottom of the hatchery basket. Maybe I should say in addition that some hatcheries use paper occasionally in flocks where they expect a lot of exploders, because then the mess from the exploding egg will be absorbed by the paper in the basket. A question which is sometimes a bit under debate is, what can you say about the temperature of the water for cleaning? If you recall the Sinner circle, temperature helps in getting better results. A higher temperature is helping in getting better results, but there is a maximum. The problem with high temperature water, more than 40 centigrades, is that albumin, proteins, will start to coagulate. And when protein starts to coagulate, it's more difficult to clean. And in general, when we do clean setters and hatches by foaming, we can say we do not need really this high temperature of water. Also for safety reasons, we say that water should not be warmer than 40 centigrades. So that is for when we clean setters and hatches and we use foam. The machines that we are using for cleaning hatchery baskets, I know some customers, they say that they like to use warmer water to get better cleaning results. And it is partially true, because it helps to melt the fat. Fat has a melting point which could be as high as 60 centigrades. But you have to be careful that you don't make the temperature too high. First of all, I'm worried for myself about the coagulation of the proteins, but when the water temperature is too high, you have to think about safety risks, but also your material might not be able to work with these high temperatures. So it depends a bit on the quality of your hatchery basket if you can go to very high water temperatures. I think, looking to the time, and looking to the remaining questions, I'm not able to answer them anymore. So I propose to end here, and the questions that I did not answer, we will answer them definitely next week. And I would like to say that all of you who watched will receive a webinar replay and a handout of this presentation. You are also invited to visit our knowledge section at our website, www.pasreform.com, where you can find quite a lot of articles dealing with hygiene. And I also would like to invite everybody to attend the next webinar, which will be in October, in next month. Thank you very much.